Hi everyone, welcome to Pediatric Restorative Dentistry Part 3A. In this particular part, we are going to discuss about strip crowns in restoring primary anterior teeth. By the end of the lecture, you will be able to explain the uses, indications, contraindications and the procedure for strip crowns. In the other part, that is 3B, we are going to look at stainless steel crown, and Part 3C, we are going to look at ART techniques. So let's begin. Now, how are we going to restore a teeth in which we have caries something like this? If you see all these brown spots, brown areas, they're all decalcified to structure because of caries. So this would be a case of early childhood caries. Okay, you can see a lot of caries lesions, and the problem in this particular situation is the clinical challenge is that the tooth has caries on multi surfaces, right? So we cannot do a composite restoration on these single surfaces. So we need a composite restoration which can cover the whole tooth, or any kind of restoration which can provide full coverage crown. So essentially we need something which can provide full coverage crown. Okay, so when we do this using composite resin, it is called as strip crowns. So here, if you see in the picture, this is a strip crown. It's also called as celluloid crown forms. And basically we use composite resin. What we do is we fill this crown with composite resin and we put it all over the tooth, and then we cure it, and then we remove the crown. This is a celluloid plastic crown. So we remove the crown and the composite resin takes the shape of the particular tooth, and it takes the retention of the residual dentine, the residual enamel of the tooth structure, the micromechanical retention, and the restoration stays on the tooth. They are less resistant to wear and fracture more readily because of the retention, because retention is micromechanical. So if we do not have good etching, or if we have more dentine, less enamel, then the micromechanical retention will be poorer. But on the good side, it is very aesthetic because we are using composite resin restorations. So advantages, superior aesthetics, the cost of the material is reasonable, and the placement time is also reasonable because this can be done quickly at chair side, does not require lab. Only disadvantage is that it is a technique sensitive procedure because we are using composite resin, and therefore the moisture control is very, very important, and the technique or dentine bonding is also very, very important. As compared to the stainless steel crown, which uses the mechanical undercuts for retention, of course, strip crowns with composite resin does not provide that kind of retention. And because of this problem, we cannot use it in patients who have got bruxism habit, the grinding habit, or deep bite because of the forces generated on strip crowns with the composite resin will not be very retentive, and they will fracture and break off very easily. Since moisture control is an issue, it is very difficult to perform this procedure in an uncooperative child. But the latest technique is we are now using GIC resin, modified GICs in uncooperative patient where moisture control is not an issue, with this celluloid crown forms to obtain our objective of restoring form, function and aesthetics. So this celluloid crowns can also be used with GIC, that is resin modified GIC, not the conventional GIC. Okay, so how do we go about doing a strip crown? First is you have to select a strip crown and make sure the dimension of the crown selected will be approximately equal to the dimension of the tooth that we are going to restore. So there are two ways of doing it. So check mesiodistal like this, as shown in the picture. Okay, you can measure it with a divider, or you can simply put it against the tooth that you want to restore and use the most appropriate ones. Then what you do is, you once you have selected the crown, you remove the decayed area. So if you see in this picture, this is multi-surface decay. So we remove decay from all the surfaces, and if the decay is approaching pulp or involving pulp, we perform pulpotomy or pulpectomy, or if it does not, we can also do deep caries management by applying a layer of hard setting calcium hydroxide in the deepest part of the cavity and then continuing with the restorative procedure. Since the composite resin that we're going to use as a restorative material, it needs space. Okay, to create that space, we have to do some crown preparation. This is a very minimal crown preparation. And if you see here in the proximal areas, we have to remove about 0.5 to 1 millimeter of crown to make space for the composite resin that we are going to use to restore the tooth function. So ensure that the proximal walls are parallel and the gingival margins have feather edge or knife edge. Okay, we do not need chamfer or a shoulder. It has to be a knife edge so that the composite merges with the tooth structure efficiently. And on the facial surface also, you need to remove 1 millimeter, and on the lingual surface you need to remove 0.5 millimeter, again making sure ensuring that you have feather edge gingival margins, and then you round off all the line angles so that there is no sharp edges. Then what you do is you have to trim the crown at its gingival margin, because we have a tab here to hold the crown with, and you have to measure the incisor gingival length, and using a scissor you have to trim the gingival margin of the crown so that the incisal gingival length corresponds to the tooth that we are restoring. Then what you do is you have to place a vent hole on the lingual surface with a burr or with an explorer so that there is no air trapped. Once we fill the crown with composite resin, if there are chances that the air may get trapped, so we have to put a vent hole in the lingual surface. Lingual surface because later we can remove the crown and remove the excess, and we can polish it easily, and we do not touch the facial surface, which may already have a good finish from the composite. Then you fit the crown over the prepared tooth. You see how here we have a uniform space all around the tooth, and this is what will be occupied by the composite resin later, so we'll have a nice good finish. Okay, ensure that the crown margins are subgingival, approximately 1 millimeter subgingival, so that the transition of the composite and the tooth is not visible, so we have a good aesthetic results. Then you select the appropriate shade of the composite. Extra light is the recommendation. Then fill the crown with the composite resin material approximately 2/3 full, don't completely full. So here if you see, this is a crown form, and this is they're using capsule of the composite resin, and very gently we fill the crown to avoid any air bubble. Then you etch the tooth surface everywhere, then you bond, okay, and then you polymerize, and the prepared tooth is ready to receive the crown. Here in this picture you see the crown is seated on the tooth, and then of course you will have extra excess of composite resin flowing from all surfaces of the tooth. So before you polymerize, use your explorer or any suitable hand instrument to remove this excess, and then you can polymerize. If you polymerize without removing the excess, we will have a problem of removing the crown with this excess, and then we have to actually trim it out. So ensure that you remove the excess before you polymerize. You have to polymerize the crown from the facial surface and from the lingual surface also separately. So it will be like 20 seconds or 30 seconds facially and 20 seconds or 30 seconds lingually, depending on what kind of light core unit you are using. Then you have to remove the celluloid crown. Okay, it can be removed by placing a cut on the facial surface and then peeling it off. So this crown, celluloid crown, basically peels off, and it is very easy to remove it. And then what remains is a nice finished tooth surface and requires minimal polishing. But if you would like, you can polish it further and put a gloss over it by using appropriate finishing burrs. The other way of full coverage crown for the anteriors are called as zirconia crowns, and these are made up of solid monolithic zirconia ceramic material. It's one of the hardest material available, and these crowns are also available in different sizes, and you can choose the sizes accordingly. The advantages are it's aesthetic and is very durable as compared to the composite, and not as technique sensitive as composite strip crowns, and It takes a bit longer to place than stainless steel crown or the composite crown, but it has a very good aesthetic. The only disadvantage is that it cannot be recommended in patients with heavy bruxism, because this zirconia is a very hard structure. It will tend to abrade the opposing tooth structure, so it cannot be used in heavy bruxers, and we need greater tooth reduction for preparing zirconia crowns, because these are bulky crowns. So this is how you go about preparing the tooth for zirconia crown. So number one step is to select the appropriate crown. So we have a lot of crown sizes available in the zirconia crown kit. So we measure the mesiodistal just like this with the tooth we are trying to restore. And once we have got our crown, we go about doing the tooth preparation. Now, because this is a bulkier crown, we need to remove more tooth structure as compared to the composite. So we have to have an incisal reduction of 0.5 to 2 millimeter. Then we have to have a labial reduction of 0.5 to 1 millimeter. And these three plane extends about 1 to 2 millimeter subgingivally all along the gingival preparation. And this is to ensure the transition is subgingival, so the aesthetic is much better. Then we have lingual preparation, again up to 0.25 millimeters, and has to be 2 millimeters subgingival for aesthetic reasons. So if you see, you basically the crown is more or less prepared to receive the anterior crowns. Those are the acrylic crowns or porcelain crowns. So it's very similar crown preparation. So here also subgingival preparation, there will be a lot of bleeding from subgingival area because of the crown cutting. So it's not a very pleasant situation, but this is another technique of restoring multi-surface caries on anteriors with a very good aesthetics. The red arrows marked here are the common areas of internal interferences that, if underprepared, will make it difficult to seat the zirconia crowns. Lingual and facial reduction should meet at a thin incisal edge or the final restoration, and this thin edge helps to reduce internal interferences between the tooth and the internal surface of the crown. So basically, you have to ensure there is no undercut, there is no interference, or the crown will rock in the patient's mouth. This is how it looks like after a crown preparation to receive a zirconia crown. See here, so much gingival laceration has happened because of the subgingival crown preparation. You see in the image on the mirror, all right? Then the tooth, the margins, the proximal cut, the incisal cut, and everything has to be rounded off, otherwise the crown will not seat. Then you can have, if you see here in the picture, this is a crown number E4. Since you cannot cut the crown, if the crown is longer, incisal gingival length is longer, you need to trim the gingival margin of the crown using a high speed burr with lot of water coolant, otherwise the crown will deform. This crown is very hard, so you cannot use scissors to cut it, so you have to use a diamond point to cut it. Then you have to fill it with resin epoxy luting agents, all right, or you can also use GIC, but you can fill it up again same way, 2/3, and you have to seat it on the crown uniformly, remove the excess, and then light cure it from the facial and from the lingual side. And then essentially, before you do that, a little preparation for the tooth that I skipped. What you need to do is you have to rinse the preparation and remove all blood and residue from the tooth, and if the bleeding continues, squeeze the preparation with a moist 2x2 gauze, or carefully apply superoxol to the tissue using a micro brush. Using peroxide or alcohol, thoroughly clean the internal surfaces of the crown so that all blood and residues is removed. This is a very important step because we do not need any interference with the tooth and the crown for the retention, because if you see, there's no retention of the crown coming from the tooth. It's depending on the luting agent, so we need to have a very good close approximation of the luting agent to the tooth and luting agent to the crown. Then cementation. Central incisor should always be cemented together first and then the lateral. Apply consistent finger pressure during cementation using glass ionomer cement if you are using. The crown should remain undisturbed until the cement has completely hardened. Wipe excess cement from the facial embrasure which will allow a clearer view or facial view and ensure a better final alignment. So like I told you, the crown may rock, so you have to ensure the crown is seated properly in the direction that we want it to seat properly. Tooth labeling can be scratched off using a spoon or polished off with a coarse coffee paste. Remember, E4 we were looking at, we can remove it with a polishing paste. So this is how the crown will finally look, very aesthetic. Okay, this is post-operative 3 weeks, because you cannot see the laceration of the gingiva in this area. The lacerated gingiva has healed. So this is 2 weeks post-op. So very good aesthetic results. Most of the time you do this in children who are under general anesthesia, so that you can do crown preparation properly, so that the tooth receives a very good zirconia crown. So with this, we end in the session. I will quickly summarize what we have looked at. In a situation where we have multi-surface caries on the primary anteriors, it is very difficult for restorative material, intracoronal restorative material, to be retained, and we need a full coverage restorative technique. And those full coverage comes from your strip crowns using composite resin, or strip crowns using resin modified GIC, or it can come from pediatric anterior zirconia crowns. Okay, so the two ways we can handle it. All right, so this is it in this particular session, and we will see you in the pediatric restorative dentistry part 3 and subsection B in the next session, when we talk about stainless steel crown. All right, so it's bye bye from us.